Come on, bless him in this house today. Come on, let's bless him. Yes. Praise. Praise him. Come on, praise him. Yeah. What a good job description to have, to know that you can praise him and give him glory and give him honor. Come on, somebody, say, praise is what I do. It's my middle name. It's what's wake me up in the morning. It gets me through my day. It's the last things on my lips when I go to bed. Somebody ought to give God praise. I even dream praise. Come on, somebody, say, I'm dreaming praise. God's been so good and so kind. Yes, God, it's what I do. Amen. God is so faithful. Amen. And we honor him. Are you glad to be in the house today? If you are, come on, put your hands together and give God a praise. Yeah, it's raining outside, but oh, glory's falling in here. In Jesus' name, we give you thanks and praise, oh God. Amen. Let's give God praise for amen. Greg Cooper, great job this morning leading us in our praise and worship time. Greg is a member of our church for many, many years and now at Hopewell and doing a wonderful job there. Amen. Leading and singing. Amen. But we're just so glad you're with us today. Erica and our staff and many of our leadership is out on today. And we're just thankful and grateful that he came in to pitch hit for us. Amen. And we just thank God. And I want you to give God praise for our praise team today. Amen. Miss Terry, Kiamani, Stephanie. Come on. Didn't they do a good job? Give God a shout of praise, amen, leading us into the very presence of Almighty God. And one more time for this band, y'all. Let's give God praise for them, amen. Appreciate y'all so much what the Lord is doing. Brother Josh, amen, amen, leading that team. And we're thankful and grateful for God's grace. God is in control, y'all, amen. That's why I can sleep at night, because I know God's in control. Come on, amen. Doesn't matter who's the president, who's the governor. Doesn't matter what's happening on my street. Doesn't matter what's happening anywhere. It's that God is in control. He's sovereign. He's over it all. And we're thankful and grateful for what he is doing in and through us. Amen. On today. Amen. So we're glad to see you. We're in a third week of a series that we launched a couple of weeks ago called Simplifying Our Lives, learning how to simplify our lives, learning how to get the chaos and the clutter out of our life. And today, last week, we talked about time and looking at time. How many of y'all enjoyed that message last week? Come on, somebody. Amen. Learning how to, amen, not letting time rule us, but we ruling it. Amen. And the Lord blessed us in a mighty and powerful way. And today, we're going to talk about that other enemy that robs us of being our best and doing our best. That is money. Come on, somebody. Oh, Lord. Amen. Good God, amen. And so we're thankful and grateful for what the Spirit of God's going to talk to us today. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the management of money and how we manage it so that we can manage our life. Amen. And we're looking forward to what the Spirit of God's going to say today. If you wouldn't, in your Bibles, open up with me to the book of Ecclesiastes. Amen, Ecclesiastes. And we'll be looking at chapter 7. We'll look at one verse there and then one more verse in chapter 10 of that same book. Ecclesiastes chapter number 7. And let's look at verse number 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse number 12. If you would turn there, it's our custom to stand for the reading of the Word of God, and we don't fall for anything else. And we're thankful and grateful for God's grace and His presence on today. Ecclesiastes 7 and verse number 12. When you got it, say, I got it. When you can't have it, need some more time, just say, I'm still looking for that book. I ain't never even seen that in the Bible. What in the world? Ecclesiastes. Amen. Amen. But it's a tremendous book. It's in the book of wisdom, in the series of wisdom. It's right after the book of Proverbs. And so if you would find Psalms, Proverbs, and then you'll find Ecclesiastes. All right? And it's on page 688 for me. Come on. Amen. And maybe you'll find that as well. All right. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 12 says this. Watch what it says. Wisdom is a shelter, as money is a shelter. Uh-oh. But the advantage of knowledge is this, that wisdom preserves the life of its possessor. It's interesting. He says wisdom is a shelter. Wisdom is a cover. It's a protection. It's a defense. And so is money. it's a defense, it's a shelter, it's a gate, it's a protector around your life. We're going to talk about that today, how you can do that if you live the simple life. Also, look at verse number 19 of chapter 10. Turn over a few books to chapter 10, and look at verse number 19. Chapter 10, yes, of Ecclesiastes, and verse 19 says, "A feast is made for laughter, and wine makes life merry, but money is the answer for everything." Ooh, money is the answer. King James says, "Money answereth all things." Notice it answers things, but not love. Not the things that really matter. It may answer your bills being paid or what you can do here or do there, but money is not the answer to all things. But yet, at the root of much of what we are concerned with in our life is money, and therefore, we must talk about it today so that we'll be able to understand how to use it instead of abusing it. So, Father, we pray that you'll bless now this time. Thank you for your word that is a light unto our pathway. Thank you, Lord God, for what you will say and what you will do in us and through us and in spite of us. So we give you glory, honor, and praise as, Lord God, you order our steps in Jesus' name. Have your way. Bless your word. Lord God, let us be changed and transformed by it. In Christ's name we pray. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
And amen. You may take your seats in the presence of the Lord. Had a quick little song they were going to play, but that's okay. Don't worry about it. I'll give you another. There it is. Y'all know this? Some people got to have it. Some people really need it. Some people, amen, all of us. Need to know how to use some money. Amen. You can bring it down. Money, money, money. See, our message title today is Money Management. And the subtitle is, if it doesn't make sense, it won't make dollars. If it don't make sense, C-E-N-T-S, it won't make dollars. Come on, amen. And we're gonna see God do some things today and really expose some of those hidden things within our heart today as we talk about money. Money, 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 money. Amen. And so we've got to make sure that we use it correctly. Because when we don't handle money correctly, it can create a chaotic life for you. It is. At the very root of all evil, the Bible says, is money. Amen. But at the root of much of the dysfunctions in our life, I'm going to tell you, it's money. It's either the lack of it or the abuse of it. Because we got too much and not using it in the right ways. And so we've got to talk about money. Amen. And because two things that we'll know about your life and my life, about where we're headed, two areas, looking at our calendar that we looked at last week, looking at where you spend your time, and secondly, where you spend your money is going to determine where you end up, at the end of this year or the beginning of next year. How you use your time, which is what we talked about last week, and how you spend your money, what's going through your checkbook, is going to determine the success of your life. It's going to determine a lot of the peace that you have. It's going to determine the quality of relationships that you have. And so it's very, very important for us to make sure that we talk about this, that we deal with a subject that many people don't like to touch and don't like to talk about. But we've got to in church. Because we're in the most affluent nation in the world as it relates to all of its people. In fact, 8%, we're in the top 8% of wealth if you are a person who begs for money on the street. If you are an individual, not with a job, you just go and you ask for money, amen, for people in different places, you are, watch this, in America, amen, as it relates to the whole world, you are in the top 8% of wealth of the world. That is unbelievable, isn't it? Because the majority of peoples in the world don't have what we have, don't have the conveniences that we have, don't have the access to resources that we have. And so even the poorest among us in America, and I know there's some people that are way below that, I'm not saying it, but on average, 8% of the wealth of the world is in that individuals who are in the poorest of the poor here in the United States. You're in the top as it relates to the world. Now, you may not feel like it. Your life may not look like it, but that is the truth about this globe, about this world in which we live in. And so we've got to make sure that we handle money, because our culture is not going to show us how to handle money. The culture is going to teach us how to spend it. It's going to teach us how to not to hold on to it, and not how to use it, but in a lot of ways, how to abuse it. And we've got to make sure that we do this. And we learn a lot from our family of origin. We're going to talk about this a little bit later. We learn about how to handle resources by how our family that we grew up with handled money. Some of us didn't have a whole lot of funds. We grew up with a family that didn't have a whole lot of money. Amen. And so therefore, it informs the way in which we hold money, what we do with it. Some of us spend it way more than we ought to. Some of us save a lot of it and afraid to use it because we didn't have it when we were growing up. And now that you got it, you just want to hold on to it. Come on, amen. And you become a miser and you're stingy. Some of you grew up with a lot of funds, or at least you were comfortable. Your parents were comfortable. I grew up in a lower middle class home, and we were very, very comfortable. We didn't struggle. I mean, I don't remember the lights ever being off. We always had heat. We always had something to eat. We always had everything that we needed, even a little bit more than what we needed, amen. So I grew up kind of in that environment, amen. But there were some things that I learned that were dysfunctional, come on, amen, as well. And we have to kind of unlearn some things, come on, amen. We have to unlearn some things and be aware of the impact of our upbringing. I'll come back to that in a few moments, amen. And we've got to learn these things and not let culture or where we've come from, amen, make us, if you would, dysfunctional with funds and resources, but that we've got to make sure that we get our wisdom from the Word, because the Word of God has much to say about how we handle money. In fact, there are over 2,000 scriptures in the Bible on money, handling money, getting money, using it in the correct way. Over 2,000. In fact, can I just tell you, it is the number one topic in the whole Bible. It talks more about money than forgiveness, more about money than dealing with grace, dealing with salvation, dealing with any area of in the Bible. Money is the number one topic in the Bible because it revolves around how we live and navigate our lives like nothing else. Amen? Some of us don't like this already. Some of y'all are like, this is the wrong day that I came to church. I do not want to talk about this, but you're here today, amen, and no, we're not going to lock the doors, but I'm praying the Holy Spirit will place you under arrest, and that you will sit here and listen to what he has to say through this, amen, preacher on today, amen, because oftentimes the church is not balanced in its handling of money. There's some preachers that I call prosperity preachers, and they preach, amen, God wants everybody wealthy and everybody's going to have all kind of money, and that's a lie. That's not true. I've already said that there are people, look at the around the world, amen, 92% of the world is living in squatter, if you would, amen. You can't preach that. The Bible is such that we have to preach it, if you would, that it's going to be holistic no matter where someone lives. And so, everybody's not going to be wealthy. Everybody's not going to be, come on, I can't teach you a message, spin around three times, say Jesus, 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 and then money going to fall out the sky. That's not going to happen, amen. You got to go to work. Amen. You got to save. You got to invest. You got to be a good steward of what God has entrusted to you. Amen. So it's not about some magic, amen, that we've got to do. If that's not it, it's not about prayer lines. I grew up in the 1970s in church where they had prayer lines. And they had, you know, if you wanted money and you needed God, they had a $50 prayer line. They had the $10 prayer line. And then they had the change prayer line. Come on, somebody, amen. And you know, and the idea was the people in the $50, God was gonna double and triple and quadruple your money. And those of y'all who were giving change, well, we'll pray for you. You know, it was terrible. It was terrible manipulation. So that end, and then you've got the end where some people believe that the church should never talk about resources and money. So the poverty, that we're supposed to be just poor, poor in spirit. Because, you know, the Bible says we're poor in spirit, but don't say we ought to live like that. That's not it. God has a plan for you in heaven, but he also has a plan for you on earth. He does. Yes, there is mansions that he has for you in heaven, but I'm not saying you're going to have mansions on this earth, but he wants you to be at least manage what he's given to you and live as well as you can with it. There's nothing wrong with us talking about resources and handling resources correctly. Amen? Because it's hard for you to be able to be the man, the woman, the family, the Christian that God has called you to be, and you're worried about money. You got to talk about this because I'm going to tell you, most of your prayer requests are about money. And listen, let me tell you, half of what you pray about can be solved with a good check. Oh, y'all don't like my preaching already. Come on, somebody. Half of what you are all worried about and stressed about can be handled with a good check. Come on, amen. In fact, I'm going to bring it up. 70% of what you pray about probably can be handled with a good check. And the issue is you've got to learn how to manage what God has given to you because God is sending you the answer. The Bible says while you're praying, he's already sending an answer. Come on, while you're praying, they're already depositing funds into your account for you to be able to deal with the trouble, the trauma, and the tragedy, and the stress and strain you're under. But the problem is when he puts it in the bank, amen, we put it in the hand of others. We put it in the hand of Visa and MasterCard. We put it in the hand of Stonecrest Mall. We put it in the hand of Walmart. We put it in the hand of restaurants. Come on, somebody. God is sending you the answer, but you're taking the answer and you're redistributing it in the wrong places. Oh, I'm preaching already. If y'all come on, I'm telling you. So if what we've got to do is understand how to handle money because God has called you to do some amazing things. He's called you to do great things that will change this world, but it's hard to change the world when you're scared they're going to repossess your car. I mean, it's hard for you to pray about, amen, healing cancer off of somebody and dealing with people who are in addiction issues when you are stressed out whether or not you're going to have a home when next month. Because they're repossessing it. Anybody know what I'm talking about here today? It's hard for you to do those things. And there are some really deep spiritual people, amen, who are really deep and spiritual about a whole lot of stuff. But when it comes to money, amen, they want everybody to be quiet about it. But that is not it. We've got to talk about how do we manage our resources effectively. Come on, somebody, amen. Because I am so sick and tired of these deep people who so deep in the Word of God, amen, and they so deep about God, but they don't manage their money right. Amen? And they don't ever talk about it. They don't want the church to ever even mention anything about funds and resources because they're so deep. Amen? They don't see that as a deep topic. But they so deep, and yet they always come in, amen, needing somebody to pay their bills. Or when they die, they got to have family members to be able to raise an offering at the funeral to be able to bury them. And they were so deep. Oh, y'all don't hear me. Oh, God. Oh, okay. It's nothing great spiritual about a man dying and not being able to have the enough to be able to put you in the ground. There's nothing spiritual about that. Come on, nobody's going to tell you. I'm going to tell you that. That's not deep and spiritual. For you to be able to, amen, constantly, amen, I'm doing things for your wants, but you begging your needs. There's nothing spiritual about that. It's not. In fact, it's really not a good witness for us Christians to be the people who, amen, have to have creditors calling us. It's not a good witness for us to say that we know the Lord, that we serve the Lord, amen, and we're in a situation. Now, everybody goes through hard times. I've gone through it. I'm not judging you. Lord knows if I told you my whole story, I have blown so much. But it's because of blowing stuff and messing it up that I've learned. Come on, somebody. Amen. I've learned, you know what? I got to make sure I keep my ducks and my dollars in a row because I don't ever want to be in that situation, amen, that I was in the past. Anybody know what I'm talking about here today? And what we've got to do is that we have got to become good stewards of resources because we read the scripture in Ecclesiastes 7:12 that money becomes a shield. Money is a shelter. Money, if used correctly, can become a defense for you. It can become a wall of protection around you. So that when tragedy comes, and it comes to all of us, Jesus says, in this life, you're going to have trouble. Amen. But if you got some resources, you can handle the trouble. If you got some money, extra money, you can deal. When tragedy comes, when your car carburetor goes out, your water heater goes out at the house, when something goes bad, come on, amen, you're not sitting there tripping like, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. Come on, amen, because you can go down and get your car fixed because you've got some extra money set aside for those things that are going to happen.
Y'all don't hear me today. That when you've got money, it's a defense. So that when you got a cough or you got a knot that's going up on your hip somewhere, you don't sit there and say, pray it away. And nothing wrong with prayer. Please hear me. Pray for it. Come on, amen. Lord, there's a knot on my hip. Pray. Oh, God, I know you're a healer, but you need to go to the doctor too. Anybody know what I'm talking about here today? And it's a blessing for you to be able to have the ability to pray and seek the face of God, but it's also a blessing for you to be able to have some insurance, to have some money, to have some co-pays so you can go and have somebody check it out. Anybody know what I'm talking about here today? Oh, Lord, dear Jesus, I'm here by myself. You got to make sure you do that. That you take care of those things that concern life here and in eternity. And so we've got to make sure that we do that. And we have balance in our life. And that's what we want to do. That's what the simplified life is about. It's not just about, amen, having our head in the clouds. It's about making sure that our feet are firmly planted here on earth. And because many times we're not. And because people are good about perpetrating a fraud. You watch television and you see those celebrities with those cars and them nice houses and all this stuff. I know people who are in the banking world who bank those folk. And here's what they say. They ain't got no money. The majority of those people that we see are leasing the cars that they're driving around, amen, for 6 months at a time. And many times they get repossessed, amen. And the houses that they live in, and we're watching them on these reality TV shows. They film so many of them here in Atlanta, amen. They're rented houses. That ain't their house. And as soon as the filming is over, they out. They only rent it for 3 months or 4 months so that they can look good. Come on, amen. On the camera, and then they go to their apartment where they really live. Y'all don't like my preaching already, do you? And you see this, and then what we do is we say, that's the standard. That is not the standard. That's not the standard. That's not what God has for us. Amen. It's not important. We can't do that. You have to look at the relationship that you have with money. You have to look at your relationship with God, absolutely. But you have to look at your relationship that you have with money and ask yourself some very hard questions. Can I balance my checkbook? I mean, it's no great to have a powerful prayer life, can pray cancer off of folk, but you can't balance your checkbook. Oh, y'all don't hear me today. Can preach and sing and administrate in a ministry so well, but you can't take care of the basics of life. So it's a contradiction. It's an oxymoron. Amen. And do you know what's coming in and going out? Do you know? The Bible says, know the state of your flocks. Know the condition of your flocks. It's talking to shepherds, and it's saying, know where your sheep are. We got sheep running all over the place. Come on, amen. We don't know what we have coming in. Most of us know the check. We know how much money that we are that we make because we know we see that pay stub, right? You know what comes in, but we have no idea what goes out. You don't know where it went. I mean, you know, you get paid on Friday, and then by Saturday, you're going, I don't know what happened. Well, you spent it. You know, you get it on Friday, and then by Monday, you can't wait to go to work because, you know, I'm waiting on Friday again. Because I spent it all. And the places that we're spending it are places that don't add value to us. Don't give us an asset. It's depleting and taking from us. And it's okay to go and do stuff and enjoy and do all these things that we all do. I'm not saying that. Go and enjoy life, but make sure you can afford it. Make sure that it's not going to be. Here's what God's word says. He gives to us, he blesses us, but he adds no sorrow with it. Much of what we go after adds sorrow. Because it ain't fun to be able to drive it around in a car and you can't insure it. It's not good to be able to drive around a car and you can't put gas in it. And it requires, y'all want these nice big old cars? Nothing wrong with that. Get it if you can. But no, you got to put high test gas in it. You can't put the $2.05. You got to put the $2.75 in that car. So yeah, you want the nice car, but it requires $800 wheels. You can't go to Big Ten Tire and say, give me a Dunlop. You got to get Michelin. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Oh, y'all don't like my preaching already. I'm trying to help you so that we can live well. Do you know what's coming in, what's going out? Are you living paycheck to paycheck? What's your relationship with money? Is it dysfunctional? Is it dysfunctional? Because oftentimes we learn from our family of origin, where we grew up, our parents. And no blame, we can't blame folk because we are responsible for the choices we're making today. But you do have to understand that the values and what's important to you is based upon the family of origin. So like in our house, we spent money when we were happy. And we spent money when we were sad. We spent money on everybody's birthday. And I mean, presents, whether or not there was funds to do it. And Christmas. Just feel. Christmas. Christmas, just the tree, it just feel. It things all up under because Christmas, we go into debt. Whatever it takes. No Kmart, layaways. No, we didn't do that. No. We're going to charge it. And we're going to pay it over time so the kids can have a good Christmas and play with the toy that we spent $100 on and they can play with it for 30 minutes. How many of y'all that happened to your kids this year? Come on. You spend all that money running around, all that gas to try to get the most invaluable little toy that everybody wants, and then you finally get it. The kid opens it up and says, oh, and then next thing you know, they're upstairs on their phone watching Netflix or playing with the box. Okay. And here's what if we didn't have it in the home, if we didn't have it in the checkbook, I should say, if it wasn't there, here's what we did. We went out and borrowed it so we could spend it. So if it wasn't in the checkbook, let's go out and let's borrow it. Let's go and try to get some extra money. Amen. Because they got rooms to go. Say, if you buy this furniture, you don't have to pay it off until 2026. Don't give me time to pay. I love rooms to go. Go ahead. It's 2020. I ain't got to pay this off for 2026, but miss a payment. Your 0% interest in your 2026 has just moved up. Your time table. And you're paying 27% interest now and 32 and 39% interest because you missed one payment. Oh, Lord. See, the issue is we get pleasure from spending. It's called the pleasure principle, and it's true. There's endorphins biologically within us. There's certain pleasures that we enjoy that sends a sensation through our bodies. Amen. It's God gave it. It's part of the pleasure principle. It's meant to keep us to keep going back to that thing that gives us pleasure. And so we want to experience that again. And so many of us, when we shop, in fact, almost all of us, when we shop and we get something that we like, it gives us for a moment that sense of, wow, you feel so good. I mean, I want it. Even if it ain't my size, I'm going to make myself fit into it. Because I like the way this makes me feel, even if I don't look good. And you want that rush. That's, America is addicted. Here's the number one addiction in America, endorphins. It's endorphin. We get it through drugs by putting it up our arm or smoking it or sex or some kind of thrill issue or spending, which is the number one. Spending. It's the number one addiction. I got to do it because I want that fit. But here's the thing that happens after you spend it. Buyer's remorse. Because there's the letdown that happens. There's the letdown where you go and you get, before you even get to the car, you're going, I don't know if I need, you walking with the bag. I don't know. Y'all laughing because it's true. You're walking like, should I go back and put this because that little feeling is gone. Every time. But what you do is, no, I'll just do it. And I'll just, they gave me 30 days to take it back. I'll take it back if I don't, and you never do. You put it in the closet with those other stuff that you should have taken back. And there we are. I mean, how many pairs of shoes do you need? I mean, do you need? I knew the ladies, I was gonna lose half of y'all. I knew it. But honestly, how many pairs of shoes do you need? I mean, you need them. I'm not saying that. But you only go somewhere four times a year. And two of them is at church. You come to the church banquet, that's it. And you got 50,000 pairs of shoes. Some of y'all got rooms for your shoes. That you've worn once. And you always go back to that same rusty pair. You always, I mean, with all your shoes, you still wear them same little, because they're so comfortable. They're so comfortable. Are you all right out there? God, help us to live simple. I'm not trying to say poverty. That's not what I'm not a poverty preacher. I'm not preaching that at all. I mean, do well. Enjoy if you have it, but make sure you can afford it. Make sure that you have it and it doesn't have you. So that you can be free to do what God's called you to do. That's my whole goal today, is to get you to be able to do something that so you can be free to do what God has called you to do. So you can be free to be the man, the woman, the Christian that God has called you to be. So, Lord, help us to be able to use money correctly. Help us to understand how to deal with funds and resources correctly. So that we can, amen, not spend money on Gucci watches and tennis shoes and big old hubcaps on our Toyota Corolla. Or have more money on our feet and in our hair than we have in our wallets. Because in America, African-American community is losing its middle-class status in a large way, and it's not Donald Trump's fault. I mean, we blame him for a whole lot of stuff, but you can't blame him for you buying them red bottoms. Because money in and of itself is not evil. In fact, money is neutral. It's what we do with it. Jesus said this. The word of God says, I should say, it's the love of money that's the root of evil. Say love of it. Love. It's the love of money. It depends on whose hands. You can give $1,000 on one side of the street to start a recovery program like we have Celebrate Recovery here on Tuesdays and Thursday nights. Amen. For you to be able to help. We can do $1,000. You can take $1,000 and say we're going to help and support this recovery effort to be able to help. And on the other side of the street, a drug dealer can take that same $1,000 and buy drugs to infiltrate the whole community. The same $1,000 can help get people off drugs or keep them on it. Money is neutral. It's what we do with it. It's how we use it. Do we use it to advance the kingdom of God? And when we don't, let me tell you what happens. What happens? We become evil. Remember last week, I mentioned this, I just glanced at Matthew 25. Remember the guy who had one talent and one had two and one had four? We talked about that last week, right? The one that had one, remember he buried it and he didn't use his resources correctly? What did the master say about him? Wicked. He says, you're wicked, lazy and wicked. You are lazy, wicked servant. You are wicked. He said, wicked, wicked, why? Because you didn't use resources right. I put something in your hand, and you are wicked because you didn't use it the way I wanted you to. Now, one of the reasons why I believe he says this is because, and English works better than any other language, but evil spelled backwards means what? Live. So evil could be seen in an Americanized culture as living backwards. That living backwards. So whenever we're living backwards, which what I'm defining as living against the word and will of God, living against the purposes of God, living against what God has called us to be and called us to do, when we live against what God has said, we are evil. We are living backwards, and many of us are living backwards. We're doing things backwards. We're not doing things the right way, and that is evil. Because God says, I've entrusted those resources to you, and you're using them against what I gave them to you for. Yeah, I want you to enjoy life. I want you to be prosper even as your soul prospers. I want you to do those things. Yes, I want you to enjoy life, live in a nice house, go on nice vacations, drive a nice car, all that stuff. But you're forgetting me. He told them in Haggai chapter 1, amen, y'all got panel houses and you living here and you got this, and then my house is in ruins. You're living backwards. And he called them evil. You're not good. You're not doing well. And therefore, I'm putting holes in your purse that I am allowing the devourer to come into your field and destroy your crops, because I am not going to let you take my resources and then abuse yourself and everything else with it. Because God says, I demand to be first. Because at the heart of everything that pulls us away from God is money. It is. It is. The heart of money is the root of all evil. It is at the heart of whatever it is. Money somehow is involved in that peace. You can't serve God and money. Jesus is real good about that, isn't he? And I'm coming back to that in a moment. It's the love of money that's the root of evil. You can't fall in love with it. And many of us fall in love with it and what it can do and what it makes us feel like and what it makes us look like. But you gotta fall in love with the source of money. The source of money is God. He's the one. Wealth, the Bible says, comes from not the east or the west. It comes from the hand of God. That is him who gave it to us. And what we've got to do is make sure, God, source, am I using this resource in the right way? And I can't fall in love with it, nor the things it can buy. Because we are so prone to do that. We need it, but we can't love it. It's nothing wrong with needing it. It's nothing wrong with trying to make it and starting a business or using your money. Nothing wrong. That's all good. But don't love it. Don't love it. You cannot love it. You have to understand it is a tool. It's a tool to advance the kingdom, to advance your purpose. We spent all of last year living on purpose, understanding our purpose. And God entrusts resources for you to be able to know and nowhere to go, but also having some resources to be able to move in what he has called you to do. You can't do it. God will bless you if you don't worship money. If you don't worship the things that money buys. I'm going to talk about that a little bit later as well. God looks at our heart. He looks at our heart, and he looks at the motive for why you want it. You got to ask yourself, why do I want it? Why is it important for me to have that and not this? Why did I buy this that's cheaper and I had to go to this? Why? And a lot of it is taste and preference. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. But why did I go into debt to get this when I could have afforded this that was cheaper and better and would have given me more margin in my life? Given me more boundary. Given me more room to maneuver in my life. We have to ask ourselves the question, do I get this extra? Do I go after the money and all that stuff to show off so people will think I'm that and a bag of chips? Do I need to prove to people that I made it? Sometimes that goes back to our background. Many people who are first generation money folk, nobody in your family's ever had money. Now you got money. Now you've got to work hard to show and prove people I made it. But can I just tell you something? They don't care. The people we try to impress don't really care. I learned that a long time. People I tried to impress in my past didn't care anyhow. In fact, they were talking about me. Are you trying to get money and use the resources that money can bring to rub it into the face of somebody who pulled away from you, an ex? Are you trying to prove something to somebody that you made it in spite of them? I don't know. You got to look at your motive for it, because the motive is to help. It is to advance the kingdom of God. It is for you to be able to leave a legacy for your family. It is for you to be able to live comfortably, to be able to live in peace, to be a good witness to the world of this is how God takes care and preserves and provides for his people. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, we got to make sure that we do this. One of the reasons why God calls us to tithe is giving 10%. I know many people aren't there, but you can start somewhere. Even if you're not at 10%, you can start at 2. You can start at 3 and say, I'm going to trust God with this, because what it does is it releases you from the curse of materialism and selfishness. That's what tithing does, because it says, God, I know that you're the source and you gave me these resources, and I'm going to return a portion of this back to you to show you and myself and the world that nothing is beyond you, that you are number one, that there's nothing that takes your spot. And so I am going to return a portion. It keeps me from selfishness and materialism, and I'm not going to begin to worship these things you bless me with. Every time he blesses, amen, you with something, you ought to cast down every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And that's what materialism is. It is trying to exalt itself against the knowledge of God and the presence of God. And when you give, you're beating down at that golden calf that wants you to worship it. You want God to know you're a good investment. God, you can trust me, because I'm not going to take the things you entrusted to me and then use them against you. A few weeks ago, I talked about Israel. We were not talking about money and resources. We were talking about something else, a whole other aspect of this particular text. But we were talking about when Israel made the golden calf. Remember Aaron? Moses is on the mountain. Remember that? Moses went on the mountain. He was there getting the Ten Commandments. He stayed longer than what the people thought he should stay. And they got a little like, well, we need to make another God before Moses come back. Because every time Moses come back from God, he come back with more rules. So let's get another God that we'll follow, so we ain't got to follow this other God's rules when he come back. So he went to Aaron. Aaron is sitting there. He's a weak leader. And Aaron, and he said, Aaron, make us a God. So Aaron said, okay, what I'll do is give me all the gold and earrings you have. Now, they were ex-slaves. They were just weeks away from being slaves. Amen. And they got gold. Where'd they get it from? They got it from the Egyptians, who, when they left Egypt, said, y'all got to get up out of here. And here's our stuff. We're tired of these plagues. We're tired of all this death and destruction that you're leaving behind. Here's the gold. Take it. Maybe it'll appease your God, and we'll give it to you, and y'all go. And so they got gold earrings and gold necklaces and a lot of bling and all this stuff. And when they wanted to make a god in the desert, Aaron said, take the earrings off your ears, and let me melt it down, and I'll make a golden calf for you. Now, where'd they get the golden calf gold? From their own ears. Where'd they get it? On their ears. God gave it to them. They're going to take the monies that God gave to them and then make an idol that they'll worship. The gold that God gave, they made it into an image and then worshiped it, danced around it, celebrated it, prayed to it. A cow, a golden cow that can't even give milk. Oh, have mercy. Can't even say moo. And they wanted so much to be like the other nations that they were willing to take away the God who took them out of slavery. Do you know where God has brought you? How many of y'all, you know where God has brought you? Some of y'all came from Fatback. Fatback was the main source of meat you had. Come on, somebody, amen. Fat, y'all, some of y'all didn't grow up with that, amen. But there's some folk that know, amen, that it was the gristle. Come on, amen. You chewed it up until it was gone. On the fat back, you ate the fat back, amen. It was a little sliver of meat on it. You ate all the fat, and then when you got down to the gristle, you chewed it till it tastes like gum, till it was chewing gum. I'm glad that most of y'all don't even know what I'm talking about, but some of y'all do. Anybody, come on. God brought you through all of that. And then you're going to take the God who brought you through that and then trade it for an idol? A golden calf? And that's exactly what they do. They begin to worship the golden calf. They worship it. And that's what we do. We take the gold, we take the resources. God gave you an education. He brought you through. You're the first generation person who's gotten a bachelor's degree or a master's or a doctor degree in your whole family. I mean, you're the first one graduated from high school. And then you're going to take that, and then you're going to take the resources and do, and make a God and start worshiping it? No wonder God's jealous. The first commandment and the Ten Commandments, have no other God before me. I'm one God. I'm here. I'm the guy. I'm the one. I'm the boss. I'm large and in charge. And I forbid you to have any other God before me. And if you have any other God before me, I'm going to attack it. I'm going to attack it. It's kind of like the wife who works hard to provide for the family along with the husband, and they have a joint account, and they put their money in the account together, so her money's in there with his money that he worked for and what she worked for, and then that joker gonna go and take the money out of the joint account and take some other floozy out to Old Country Buffet. You're gonna take money that your wife put in the joint account to take some floozy to Cracker Barrel. No wonder she slashed your tire. No wonder she went off. No wonder you better not go to sleep. You're gonna have some grits before breakfast. Oh, y'all don't hear me. Somebody ought to give God some praise. Y'all don't hear me. God is the same way. He is not going to let you cheat on him and be adulterous on what he has blessed you with. And when we take the resources he's given to us and then we go and cheat on him with the golden calf, no wonder he has an attitude. Oh Lord, I'm still up here by myself. We got to be careful. Because even Christian folk, we can hide behind our religiosity and look like God is number one. It's not. That's what happened to the rich young ruler. Y'all know in the scriptures, rich young ruler came to Jesus. Rich young ruler. His description is rich, number one, young, and he's a ruler. But the first description is he's rich. I wish I had time to develop this, but I'm not. Rich young ruler. He comes in. We don't know his name. We know what he's worth. We don't know his name, but we can look at him and know money is walking in. And he comes in very pious, very haughty, and he says, Jesus, I have kept all the law. I keep all the Ten Commandments, all the Talmud. I follow all of the 617 laws of the Old Testament. There's nothing I don't do. I do it all. I serve in the children's ministry. I help with the food programs. I work with people here and there, and I'm at church or at synagogue every single day. I am righteous. What else must I do? Here's what Jesus said. He looked at him. He looked back, cased him back. Kind of, you know, I like, Jesus had like his lean. You know, I kind of, my mind, you know, limped back. And he looked at him. He said, take all your money that you have in your 401k, all your money that you have in your mutual funds, all your money in the bank account, sell it. Get rid of all your bling, all your gold, your boats, and your houses, and your RV, and all that. Sell all of that. Take it and give it to the poor. Here's what the man said. Can't do that. You asking way too much. Asking way too much. Jesus says, if you do that, here's what I want you to do. You're going to be one of my disciples. If you do that, I want you to do that, sell that, sell everything, don't have nowhere to live, live with me, do this, and hang with me and us 12. Here's the thing, here's the big thing. This guy was going to become number 13. This guy had an offer from Jesus, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, to say, I'm going to make room for you to be number 13. All you got to do is show I'm number one. All you got to do is get rid of all that materialism. All you got to do is, I mean, lay it all down, amen, and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to make you number 13. He could have been number 13, y'all. He said no. God makes an offer to us all the time for us to be able to come close to him, to be entrusted with great wealth and spiritual wealth, with great wisdom, with great opportunities. And many times, because of those opportunities, it will require us to let go of some of our little hidden idols. We say no to it. As some of you in this room today, last week, I was talking a little bit about sex trafficking and how we're getting ready to get involved in the sex trafficking piece in 2020 and all that stuff. And many of you ladies and men came up and said, I want to be a part of that. And that was great. And that was good. Amen. And I saw in some of your eyes, man, this is what I want to do. It's what I've been called. I feel like this is what God has called me to do. And I believe that for everybody that came up and said that to me last week. But here's what I thought when I was preparing this and I was looking at it. not about anybody who came up, but I was just thinking, man, here's an opportunity for someone who feels called by God to help people in sex trafficking. Their whole life, this is what they wanted to do. They wanted to be able to give their life to help somebody in sex trafficking, help broken young women, help to restore their lives and give them hope again. This is their whole calling. And I thought, what if God said, hey, amen, I got a directorship. Maybe this organization that we're going to be connecting to has an opening, and for some reason they choose you to say, you can be the new director of this. We're going to pay you, but it's $10,000 less than you make today. We're going to pay you, but it's going to be $10,000 less than what you're paying. I wonder how many people would say, I can't do that. I mean, this is the thing they say is their passion. This is what they say is their calling. This is what they say God is calling them to do. Amen. And then they got an offer. God is opening a door like he opened for this rich young ruler to join him. And now they're saying, join our team. Not only join it, lead it. And you, because of $10,000, because of a hidden idol, say, no, I got too many bills. I can't be doing that. And you don't trust that God, amen, can make up the difference of the 10,000. You don't know how God, you don't know what God's, oh, y'all don't, I don't know how many, I don't know who you are, but many of you all have missed the opportunities of what God has provided for you because you've been looking at the dollars. You've been looking at what's in your purse and in your pocketbook and your wallet and not been looking in the face of God who can provide for you in so many and sundry ways. And like the rich young ruler, you sadly walk away because you think you have great wealth. The Bible says he walked away because he had great wealth. No, he didn't. He was poor. Here's my thing. If I ever preached on him, he was poor. He's the poorest man in the Bible. The poorest man in the Bible because he could not see the richness of Christ standing before him, offering him an opportunity of a lifetime. And many of us have our hidden idols, hidden idols that we just can't see. Nobody can see it. But God knows how to touch something and ask of us something that will expose our hidden idols. And hopefully in this series of Simplify, God will expose our hidden idols, those little areas of that we are just saying, God, I'm going to withhold this from you. No, you can't have this. Because we have an affair with finances. We have a flirtatious, adulterous affair with credit. With money. Yeah. We go out with Visa Man. We like Visa Man. Visa Man promises that we can go anywhere. I'll take you anywhere. I'll let you do whatever. You can get what you want until you reach your limit. But then you keep Visa Man there. You don't close him out. You keep him. And then you get you another side boo. MasterCard Man. MasterCard Man promises that I got a lower interest rate. MasterCard Man says, I'll take care of you. In fact, if you transfer some of the funds that Visa Man had, girlfriend, I'll take care of you. So you go with MasterCard Man until you reach the limit. Or you miss a payment. You don't show up on time. And then he raised the interest rate from 5% to 27%. And then you run over to Discover. Somebody else, a new lover. You discover a new lover. Come on, somebody, amen. And yeah, you back, you in it again. You in the game again. And you love these one-night stands with credit. You love these one-night stands with folk. Come on, amen. And you real good with these one-night stands. Amen. But don't you miss a payment. Because them jokers will cut you off and still charge and still expect for you to pay what they've given. And if you don't pay it, they'll stalk you. They'll start sending letters to your house. Come on, amen. Sometimes they'll send you so many letters, you don't even have to open it no more because you know exactly what this is. I know what this is. This ain't no love, no. This hate mail. How many of y'all get them hate mail, right? Called bills, hate mail. Scorn lovers. Scorn lovers coming at you. They'll come and start calling you on the phone, and you won't even answer the phone no more. You block their numbers, so they start calling your job. Oh, come on, somebody. I'm in the house. Y'all are sitting there quiet. They'll call the house, and then they'll let, if they call your job, and they'll let everybody know, amen, that you ran out on them. They'll let everybody know you ran out on them. You haven't been taking care of your business. And so now everybody at the job knows because they've been called two times a day, four times last week, three times the week before that. You've been dodging them and picked up a STD, a stupendous tower of debt. You can't get rid of it. Don't know how to get rid of it because you did not learn how to have financial abstinence. To be selective in what and how you, is that good? To be able to know how to be able to navigate through your life. Because just like marriage and sex, it requires credit, requires responsibility. It requires commitment, not one-night stands. And many of us aren't ready because we still got a one-night stand mentality with credit. And no wonder we're in trouble. And what you got to do is learn how to play hard to get with debt. Say that with me. Help me to play hard to get with debt. Because it's a tool, it's an asset to help build wealth in your life. So you need to make sure you do that. It's for spending, yes. It's for saving. It's for investing. But it's also for giving. And that's the way the world wants you to do it. Spend it, save it, invest it, and then give it. But God turns it on the end. He wants you to give it, invest it, save it, spend it. He wants you or give it and save it and invest it and spend it. He wants spending to be the last thing you do. But because you put him first. You put those things that God has called you to first, and we just don't do that. We have 2 billion credit cards active in the United States. When you buy something on credit, amen, a sweater for $50, they tell us that sweater is actually going to cost you double what you pay for with interest because we don't pay it off in the 30 days that we have, the grace period, a 25-day grace period. You don't pay it off. You keep it. You plan to, but you never do. And so a $50 sweater, by the time you pay it off, was really $100. 40% of us spend more than we earn. The average disposable income in America is 8%. After we pay all of our debts and all of our obligations, we have 8% to invest and 8% to give. 8% total. No wonder, amen, where we are today. Georgia's number 3 in bankruptcies. We've got to do something. Most people file for bankruptcy in the first quarter of the year because they spent all the money at Christmas. They borrowed and borrowed and borrowed at Christmas, and then they got to be bankrupt in March. This Sunday paper here, full of advertisements because they want to show you advertisements. It's not a lot of news. It's a lot of advertisements because they want you to save by spending. And you can go into debt how much money you save spending. Come and spend. See how much money you'll save. It's a recipe for disaster. Let me close with this. How do I get out of this financial mess that I'm in? And how do I live a simplified life? Well, 7 quick things, and then we're going home. Know what comes in and what comes out. Keep a budget. Let Mr. Budget tell you. Mr. Budget say, you cannot go to the movies. It's a Netflix night. When I said that at last service, somebody yelled out, or a Fire Stick night. Live by a budget. A budget directs and tells you where you can go and what you can do. Learn contentment and ask God to help you shape your motives and your desires and your goals. Stop watching so much reality TV and looking at them because it's a lie. It's a fallacy. It's a fallacy. Get off of social media and looking at other people's lifestyles and being so bad about yours. Well, look at where they're going. Look at what they're doing. Look what they're spending. Don't worry. That's them. Stay in your lane. Looking unto Jesus, the author. Hebrew writer says, look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Stop looking at other folk and look to him. He knows how to direct you. Get out of debt. Number 3, get out of debt. Get out of it. Start snowballing your debt. Find the smallest amount, pay that off, get the endorphins from paying off debt instead of getting into debt. Because when you pay it off, man, you'd be like, woo, that endorphin lasts longer. That high lasts longer. Pay it off, pay off that small bill, amen, and then don't go get more credit. Then say, I was paying $25 on that. Let me put that extra $25 on the next heavier area of debt and just keep going until you snowball your way out of it and slide your way, ski your way in this. Into financial freedom. Get out of debt. Number 4, pay off student loans. Pay them off. Some of us in our 50s and 60s, and we still paying off student loans that we got in 1964. You marching with Dr. King with a student debt, and you still got it. Listen, no. Come on. And didn't get the degree. Paying off student debt and did not graduate. Or not even working in the field that you did graduate in. And you're still paying it off. You know why we people are paying off? I got to hurry up and go. But you know why people are paying off student debt? It's not about education. And in fact, most of the time, here's what they know. The people who have student debt, they actually had the monies in grants or in other forms, in work studies and other stuff, to pay for the tuition and for much of the school stuff, the books and everything else. What happened is they got a refund. Oh, y'all don't hear me today. And how many of you know a refund is not a refund? Hey, amen. School costs $3,000, but you applied for $10,000. And so they sent you they gave $3,000 to the school to pay for your stuff. And then there was a $7,000 extra that if there's a little box that you can check and say, send that back. I don't want it. But you had them send it to your dorm room. And now you got $7,000, amen, refund that never went to education, but guess what it went to? Pizza and parties. It went to pizza and parties, and now 25 years later, you paying for pizza and parties that you can't even remember. Oh, Lord. Okay, let me move on. Number five, learn how to invest and save and put resources aside. Learn how to do that. Learn how to invest and save. Listen, it's no excuse to be able to say, I didn't know. My parents didn't teach me. I didn't understand. I didn't come from that. No, I didn't come from a lot of that either. Amen. But you can learn it. You can Google. There's no excuse. We can Google and kind of figure out. And $25 or $10 or $15 or something. Listen, you hanging out with your friends every week, right? You see, every week you're going and y'all hanging out, watching a game or going doing this. Amen. Why not start a little investment club? Say, look, let's all of us, when we get together every month, let's get $15. Bring $15, bring $20 with you, and let's figure out. We're just going to do this for this. Let's figure out for the next year or 2 years, let's figure out some stock or some mutual fund or something we're going to put it in, and let's sit down together, and let's, before we hee-hee-haw on what we watching on TV or watching a game, let's look at for 15 minutes our investments that we have put $20 in for this last year, and let's see how it grows. Let's learn from it. Let's talk. We're accountability one another, and then we're going to split the money up, and maybe after 2 years, okay, we're going to split it up, and then we're going to take our profits, and you go do it your way, and you do it your way, or maybe we'll stay together. I don't know, but guess what? Let's learn together. Instead of just coming together, amen, and giving all our money to Papa John's and giving all of our money, amen, to Wings, amen, why don't we just take $20, amen, amen, each, amen, and come and let's start some investments. Let's learn. Let's figure this thing out. That's part of what we're going to be doing later on this year. We're going to help you to be able to do that. We're going to help you to how to put together an investment club, amen, of friends that you already have. We don't want the church, don't want a dime from it. It ain't going to be nothing. I don't want to even know about it. We don't even want nothing. It's for you to be able to be, because I'm hoping that what will happen is you'll see God bless you so much that you'll tithe on it. It'll come back here. That'll be fine if you tithe and if you give. But I want you to be able to become, I want our people, amen, to be able to go, because the Bible says we perish for lack of knowledge. So we're gonna have Financial Peace University, which is another thing. We're going to help you to be able to know how to save money. And by next year, next year sometime, or half of next year, amen, sometime June of 2021, that you'll at least have 3 months or 4 months, even 5 months of mortgage payment, amen, bills, amen, saved up so that if a financial catastrophe takes place, you're not going to be destitute. We're going to help you to do that. How many of y'all would love to be able to have 3 to 4 months of everything that has to go out every month sitting in the bank account waiting? Oh, y'all don't hear me today. I'm going to help you to do that. Number six, leave a legacy. The younger you are, the better it's to start, because the older you get, the sicker you are. And the more and older you are, the closer to death you are. And it costs more. So life insurance that could have cost you, amen, $30, now in your 50s or your 60s, it's $700 a month. Amen. Or $400 or $300, I don't know. I mean, it's way more expensive. Because now you got a cough you can't get rid of. You're taking all these pills. And they're not going to insure you the way they would when you were in your 20s and 30s. Think about it. All my 20s and 30s people, where your hand? Where y'all at? 20s and 30s, where y'all at? In here. Hey, man, all right. Some of y'all scared to raise your hand. I see a couple. You need to make sure you get this. Start now. Start young. Start today. And then lastly, learn to give to God. Learn to put God first. Learn to put him first. Come on, somebody. You know I was going to say that. Learn to put him first. Maybe you're not at 10%, but maybe you're at 2 or 3% and say, I'm going to start setting aside this to show God that nothing controls me but him. And I know the standard is 10, and I'm not saying change the standard from 10. That's God's standard. But wherever you are, start where you are and say, I'm going to consistently do this. I'm going to do it. We got 5 different ways you can give in this church, all kind of different ways that you can do it. Make sure that you avail yourself to one of those. Making yourself available to say, God, before I spend money on anybody and anything else, I'm going to make sure that I put you first. I'm going to become a generous giver because it shows that I am dependent on you, oh God. And then you watch God begin to overtake you in blessing. Bible says the eyes of the Lord go to and fro across the earth looking for someone hard who's completely turned towards him that he may show himself strong on their behalf. God wants to invest in you. God wants to be, he wants you to be blessable. He wants you to be able to be somebody that he can pour into because he can trust you. Y'all don't hear me. And when you do that, you're going to have blessings that's just going to overflow. And blessings that will overtake you. Yes, it will. One of my favorite verses. Amen. I'm closing. My favorite verses, favorite scriptures of all the Bible is Psalm 23. I love Psalm 23. At the end of Psalm 23, y'all know it, Psalm 23. Amen. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. See, when you make the shepherd your shepherd, when you follow the shepherd, amen, guess what? You follow him, don't worry about it. Goodness and mercy going to follow you. See, here's what the problem is. Many of you all are chasing, amen, goodness and mercy. You're trying to run and find goodness and mercy. You all over the place trying to find goodness and mercy. But when you follow the good shepherd, when you make him number one, when you begin to let him, he'll lay you down in green pastures. He'll lead you beside still waters. And he'll make sure that even when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be worried because he'll make sure goodness and mercy follow behind you. I don't know who I'm preaching to here today, but God wants to bless you where goodness and mercy follows you. Blessings just overtake. Take you. Anybody, stop running out the blessings. Stop chasing down blessings. Blessings are supposed to chase you down. Goodness and mercy following after me all the days of my life. God wants to bless you. But you got to start making sense before you make dollars. Somebody ought to give God some praise. Come on, somebody. Come on, let's bless him in this house. Did this help today? Was that helpful? Come on, give God a praise. Thank God for it. Come on, stand on your feet if you would. Thank God for freedom. Thank God for deliverance. Thank God for setting you free. Thank God for wisdom. That's a defense against what could take us out, take us down. Father, we praise you and thank you for today. We pray that you'll bless, Lord God, these, your people. Let those who know you, Lord God, put you first. Show and prove they know you. And then yet there's some today who want a deeper relationship with you. They want to know you as Savior. Not just Savior of their finances or their resources, but of their life, of their soul, of their eternity. They want to place their eternity in your hands. Because whatever we put in your hands, you multiply it. Whatever we put in your hands, you bless it. Whatever we put in your hands, Lord God, it will prosper. And so the greatest gift that we have is our own souls, our own lives, our own hearts. So I pray that there be someone here today who would turn their life, their heart over to you in Jesus' name. I pray that they'll love you more than money, more than what money can buy. In Jesus' name. If you're here today and you want to turn your life over to Christ, I invite you, encourage you to come. Man, woman, or girl, come right now while you have time and say, Pastor, I'm giving my life to Christ. On this rainy Sunday, I want the Lord to shine his light in me. I want this sunlight to come inside of my heart. If you're here right now, would you come? Man, woman, boy, girl, come right now while you have time. Turn your life over to Christ. Praise God. They're coming. Maybe you online, you want to come. Just hit that little button that says prayer request. Let us know that you made a decision to trust Christ. And guess what? We'll contact you. Amen. But more importantly, the Holy Spirit will come right where you are right now in your living room. Right now, wherever you are. Amen. On your car or wherever you're watching us. Amen. Today, he'll come to where you are. God is so good. Amen. Let's give God praise for these young ladies. Maybe you want to come and join them. You want to turn your life over to Christ, or maybe you want to unite with this fellowship, salvation, rededication, or affiliation with this local church. Come right now while you have time.